It's on this morning's docket. That is case number 110439, State of Kansas v. Howard.
May it please the court.
Counsel for the state.
Good morning, Your Honor. My name is Craig Devine with Devine Law Office. I'm here with
Clayton Gillette of Gillette Law Office.
Mr. Gillette will be handling the rebuttal in this matter, and I would request 5 minutes for him to do so.
5 minutes is granted.
Thank you, Your Honor. The road that's brought us here in reality started in 1986 with the enactment of the National Criminal Background Check System for the purchase of firearms in the state of Kansas, and the issues that are before this court. 2002, in State v. Pollard, this Supreme Court analyzed whether or not a Missouri suspended imposition of sentence probation could be a predicate felony for purposes of felon in possession. That case specifically analyzed whether or not an individual who was currently serving a probation could be classified as a felon. In that case, the court specifically declined to reach the issue of whether or not that result would hold should somebody complete their suspended imposition of probation sentence. On September 15, 2011, Cameron Howard was traveling on State Line Road when he made an illegal left turn through the Hy-Vee gas station parking lot at 77th and State Line to avoid a traffic control device that was specifically prohibited by a City of Prairie Village ordinance. Mr. Howard was pulled over for that infraction as well as an improper seatbelt infraction. A check of his driver's license noted that he had an outstanding warrant out of the City of Leawood for an unpaid traffic ticket. He was removed from the car, placed in handcuffs, formally arrested, and seated in the back seat of a patrol car. At that point, the passenger of the car, his then girlfriend, now wife, who was approximately 7 months pregnant, was removed from the car because she had an outstanding Prairie Village warrant. She was formally arrested, however, she was not placed in handcuffs. She was seated approximately, according to the testimony of the officer, 6 to 8 feet away from the vehicle and was not handcuffed because she was deemed not a threat to officer safety. At the point she was removed, there were two officers on scene and Mr. Howard was locked safely in the back of the patrol car. At that point, Officer Chad Lohman searched the vehicle. His testimony indicated that he was searching the vehicle for purposes of discovering narcotics. He had seen a baggie sitting in the center console. That baggie had the corner of it torn out. It was not the corner of the ripped baggie. It was the remainder of the baggie after a corner had been torn from it. He described this as drug paraphernalia and believed that gave him probable cause with exigent circumstances to search the vehicle. Upon looking underneath the passenger seat, he found a loaded pistol grip AK-47 rifle of the semi-automatic variety. And although Mr. Howard was not arrested at that time for possession of that firearm, a criminal records check showed that he had 2 felony arrests out of Kansas City, Missouri, no felony convictions. Inquiry was made by the Johnson County District Attorney's Office to the Jackson County District Attorney's Office, and it was determined that Mr. Howard had served in suspended imposition of sentence probation in Missouri, and that under Pollard, that would qualify him as a convicted felon. The issue that we raised, we had filed a motion to suppress and a motion to dismiss. The state had filed a motion in limine seeking to prevent the defense from submitting evidence that Mr. Howard had submitted to a federal background check prior to purchasing that firearm from a licensed, federally licensed gun retailer in Kansas City, Missouri. The court granted the state's motion in limine and would not allow Mr. Howard to present any evidence of his lawful purchase of that firearm. That went to Mr. Howard's only defense that he had available to him in this case, which was a mistake of fact defense as to his status as a felon. The court denied the motion to suppress based on an illegal search and denied the defense motion to dismiss based on Howard not being a felon. This case was very much like an onion. As we worked through this and we peeled one layer off, we found another layer underneath. At the time, we argued the motion to dismiss I brought up to the trial court the fact that the federal background check form that Mr. Howard submitted.
Can we back up here just a moment on your first issue? Explain to at least me why Pollard and Hankins isn't dispositive of that issue, that your client in the previous underlying burglary case in Missouri pled guilty and was adjudged guilty of that crime. So are you suggesting that our holding in Pollard was wrong or is distinguished somehow, or in Hankins is distinguished somehow? Because that seems to me to be dispositive of your situation here. We have an adjudication of guilt. We define conviction under Kansas statute. Basically, that's what Pollard and Hankins finds. What's your argument that those don't apply?
But the difference, Your Honor, would be, and specifically starting with Pollard, was the court took pains in that case to note that there were some very distinct situations that applied to Pollard that do not apply to Mr. Howard.
Well, no, we distinguished the situation there was that he had not completed the probationary period of time in Missouri, as I understand it.
Correct.
And then was charged with another crime, so he didn't complete it. And then we said we'll await another day to determine the question that's before us now. So that's what we're doing. So how does that finding of an adjudication of guilt that was not there in Hankins out of Oklahoma, but is here and was here in Pollard?
The big difference.
What's the difference?
The difference is that Howard was never there was never a judgment of conviction entered against Mr. Howard. And while we have in the criminal definition,
well, there's a judgment of conviction based on Kansas statute, isn't there?
If you look at the definition of conviction, which appears in the first section of the criminal code, it says any adjudication of guilt. But when you look at what the adjudication generally is defined as, is a judgment of guilt entered. Now, in Missouri, for there to be a judgment in a criminal case, a sentence has to be imposed. The mechanism of an SIS probation, it's different than a suspended imposition of sentence probation in Kansas. In Kansas, a judge would look and say, your criminal history score and your offense level, here you are in the grid box, and we'll just use the example of somebody has a 20-month underlying sentence. Upon a plea of guilty, the court actually sentences that person to 20 months in custody in Department of Corrections. They then suspend the imposition of that sentence and place that individual on probation. That is a judgment. A sentence has been imposed. Now, that sentence is suspended and that individual is placed on probation. Missouri, it works differently. They have two distinct kinds of probation. One is an SES that's more closely resembles the Kansas probation in that the judge finds a defendant guilty.
Why does that even matter, what happens in Missouri in terms of how they handle any, for determining whether there is a finding of guilt to satisfy conviction in Kansas once there's a judgment of guilt entered?
It matters because of the interplay of federal law and state law. And what we have in the state of Kansas is a system where an SIS probation, which under federal law and Missouri state law, is not considered a conviction because no sentence is ever imposed. If Mr. Howard had been an Overland Park resident and had been charged with a crime in Jackson County and been given a suspended imposition of sentence probation, Missouri would have controlled his status. They would have said, you are not a felon. That SIS probation does not then get reported into the national background check system. That is the only system that is used for persons who wish to purchase a firearm. Now, this hypothetical Cameron Howard, who's an Overland Park resident who had gotten into trouble in Missouri, then goes to Bass Pro Shops in Olathe, and he fills out a background check form seeking to purchase a handgun. He fills out the same form in Olathe that Mr. Howard would fill out in Raytown, because it is a form, it's the only way to check and see if somebody is a felon or not for purposes of buying a firearm. That gets submitted in, it gets checked by KBI, it gets checked by the FBI, and it gets checked by the ATF. All three of those entities would come back and say, Mr. Howard is not a felon, you can sell him the firearm, Bass Pro Shops. At that point, if we accept the state's position, Bass Pro Shops has transferred a firearm to a prohibited person, and that lawful purchase has then immediately converted to an unlawful possession. The argument that the state advanced is that the state of Kansas is the sole determiner of who is and who is not a convict, except that by accepting the benefits of the federal system and not operating their own background check system, they are acquiescing to a choice of law provision that has been on the books since 1986. Since 1986, the rule has been, if you use this system, you use the federal rule for determining who is and who is not a felon. At the time Mr. Howard was arrested, that law had been on the books for 25 years. The legislature had never sought to relieve themselves of the responsibility of complying with the federal rules by setting up their own system. So what we have is we have a criminal code definition that says one thing. We have a state system and a national system that say something else. And it's not a situation where Missouri is telling Kansas, you can't decide who you think is a felon and not a felon under your laws. What is happening is the federal government is saying, when you use our system, you have to use our rules. Our rule is...
Where does it say that?
It is 18 U.S.C. 929G.
If you use our system, we're bound to use your rules, and it applies to Kansas law and how this court would interpret.
It is the only system being used. I have not found a single system or a single statute that says, if you use this background check system, that you are allowed to disregard the results of that background check system to reach a result that you prefer.
Can we, you're about out of time, and I'd like to direct you to the second issue, which certainly has to do with the probable cause determination based upon a, and I've looked at the record here pretty closely. The condition, I just want to get it, and it's hard to find, there's no picture of it, the baggie's not, but the condition of the baggie, it wasn't, that it's called twisted, but it really isn't twisted. It has a corner that is removed. Is that right?
Correct.
And so it's and the Court of Appeals seemed to analyze that as not so much of a common item, but that item would have no particular use because of its condition. And then coupled with the officer's training and knowledge, that sufficed for probable cause. So what's your argument that the Court of Appeals went too far in finding probable cause?
In this case, Your Honor, if we look at State v. Ramirez, which has not been overruled, this court specifically said that the presence of packaging that in other cases by other persons has been used to transport or store narcotics does not in and of itself rise to probable cause. The case that was most discussed in the opinion that the Court of Appeals laid down in Howard was State v. Jones. And in that case, we had a situation where the officer observed what he determined to be erratic driving, a driver who appeared to be intoxicated, who slurred their speech, and who had a baggie in the center console. There were a multitude of factors that officer relied on in thinking that he had probable cause. It was not simply one piece of evidence and the officer's training and experience. In that case, there were at least four items that the officer relied on. And in Jones, the court found there is not enough there to rise to probable cause. The issue that we have with Howard and what made this so difficult is the officer who was in a position to document this or to seize the baggie and place it in evidence didn't do so. So we weren't able to see, was the baggie torn in half? Was a little tiny bit of the corner missing? What was it twisted up? Was it anything else?
So the baggie never presented itself at the motion to suppress or in trial court?
It was not. My understanding is the baggie was not even seized. And I specifically asked Officer Lohman if the area that he was in was an area known for drug trafficking, if Mr. Howard was somebody who was known to traffic in drugs, or did he appear intoxicated? Did you smell marijuana coming from the car? And I pointedly asked him, did the baggie have any residue? And did you test it to see if it, in fact, was drug paraphernalia? All of these options were available to him there on the scene. He declined to do any of them. He simply said, that's a baggie. I'm searching the car. And his testimony, in fact, which is in the record, said, as soon as I saw that baggie, I was going to search that car for drugs, okay, no matter what.
if we agree with you that that's, that that was insufficient to find probable cause, what do we, what's your resolution to that? What should we do?
Well, if there was no probable cause to search the vehicle, and certainly a full search of the vehicle on a traffic stop where the reason for arrest is a warrant, which can be confirmed through the computer, then the proper remedy would be to suppress anything that is the fruit of that illegal search,
and
which
then
would
what
include
happens after that. We would agree with you about that. We would remand to the district court for further consideration without this evidence, or does that, is that just dispositive of the case, or
what? I believe that's dispositive of the case, Your Honor. If the search is illegal, then the finding of the gun is illegal. If there is no gun, there is no charge for felon in possession of a firearm. And so I believe that if the court were to find that the search in this case was illegal, that Mr. Howard's conviction would need to be vacated.
Any further questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
May it please the court. I'm Jacob Gonteski, Assistant District Attorney in Johnson County, Kansas. I represent the plaintiff, the appellee in this case, the state of Kansas. Cameron Howard.
Counselor, I understood that the Johnson County Prosecutor's Office, the information they had is that there were some arrests in Missouri and they had to go digging further to find out there was a suspended imposition procedure.
That's the common course, correct, Judge.
So my question is, would that Bass Pro Shops or Cabela's or wherever that was selling Mr. Howard a firearm have access to that information?
I do not know. What I do know is if they were to recover the same information the officer had that day, which was that there had been a felony arrest, and there was a case number attached to that, that they could then query the Jackson County Court if they chose to do so and obtain the record that we obtained. That's how we went through obtaining that record. The officer on the scene obtained very limited information when he ran the background check. It showed the felony arrests, and it showed case numbers attached. When our, that's the ordinary course, that's essentially where the officers stop when they arrest somebody. When our office obtains that information, we then submit a request to the other court, the court where that case originated, to learn the disposition of that case, to learn how it was resolved, and to obtain the records. That's where our office obtained those records and made the charging decision in this case. As the record reveals, and the document is in evidence, beyond a reasonable doubt, Cameron Howard is guilty. That's what the Missouri court said. They accepted his plea of guilty, they found him guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, and they adjudged him guilty. They repeat those phrases a couple of times on the first page of that document, the abstract of conviction in this case.
Does he, in light of that, and in light of our decisions in Pollard and Hankins, does a person in Mr. Howard's situation just give up his right to possess a firearm in our state?
I believe he does. Absolutely.
That's just what happens.
At least for 5 years, it is. That's absolutely my belief. The argument that he legally purchased it in Missouri is entirely irrelevant. It's not material to this case. Thus, the motion in limine was properly granted. To the same extent that a person could go to Denver and purchase a bag of weed today, legally, when they enter the state of Kansas with that bag of marijuana, they've broken Kansas law.
If he had purchased the firearm in Kansas, everything is exactly the same. The purchase is just in Kansas rather than Missouri. Does that make any difference?
It may. I don't know what would happen with the background check. That's not the case before us. Like in Pollard, the case before court.
Do you disagree with your opposing counsel's representation that nothing would be different? In other words, it's the exact same form, it's the exact same procedures. There's no difference between a purchase in Missouri versus Kansas.
I cannot
insofar
say
as
so.
What the seller does.
I cannot say so. I don't know what sellers do in the state of Kansas in terms of the background checks and what they look like. And respectfully, it was a note I made here for today. The issue regarding the federal statutes, the federal statute the defense counsel cited in argument today, was first raised in his reply brief to this petition. The petition for review does not mention those statutes. The state then filed our brief in response to the defendant's petition for review. And it was after the state filed its brief that the defendant then filed a reply brief and mentioned these federal statutes. That's where they first came up. These federal statutes were not argued at the district court level. They were not argued at the Court of Appeals. They were not argued in the petition for review. The petition for review essentially simply argues that he purchased it lawfully in Missouri. He should have been allowed to carry it here. And that's where the analysis stopped. In Pollard, the
three... You mean possess it here, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
In Pollard, the three rationales or the three avenues that were explored to determine whether or not that conviction was, or that prior offense constituted a conviction, are the same three lines of thinking that all show that this burglary that occurred in Missouri was in fact a conviction in the eyes of Kansas law. Under the statutes KSA 2151-11, this offense constituted a conviction because it included a judgment of guilty, entered upon a plea of guilty. The procedural posture of the Missouri felony, it was not akin to some sort of Kansas diversion, an agreement between the state and the defendant whereby any court withheld any judgment or anything like that. That's not what occurred here. A court adjudicated or adjudged him guilty. And finally, the construction of the term conviction for criminal history scoring in the state of Kansas, guilty, if the factual guilt has been established by a foreign state, that has occurred here. In Hankins, the Oklahoma prior offense, the Oklahoma court had not adjudged the defendant guilty in that case.
Would you address in a little more detail this conflict of laws argument raised by opposing counsel?
I have not had an opportunity to judge until today, essentially, because it was not briefed. But whether or not Kansas uses the identical forms, the identical procedure that Missouri uses, the federal forms, I can't say what a seller in Kansas would review. I don't know exactly what systems they would use to review what sort of prior offenses are on a defendant's record. That is an issue. Like the Pollard court set aside the issue of whether or not if somebody had completed their SIS and was clear of the Missouri case, that is an issue that was left for another day. I would respectfully request that the issue of whether or not a Kansas resident that would purchase a gun here in Kansas and then be convicted of this sort of offense, that's not the issue that's before this court today. That's an issue for another day as well. We don't have those facts. We don't have that record. We don't have the documents that a Kansas resident would use when they go through the background check at a Kansas gun seller. That's not the facts that are before us today. What we have here is a defendant who purchased it in Missouri. We don't have his background check documentation in the record on appeal. We didn't have that documentation at the district court level either. The state has not reviewed all of that because it was never admitted. It was never used by the defendant. The second issue in this case...
Well, before you move to the second issue, where Pollard helps you, it said that it was going to leave for another day this specific status of the defendant, but that developed the rule that the Kansas courts get to decide whether it was a felony conviction. And I have a little problem with that. Convince me why Kansas gets to tell or gets to decide whether Missouri did in fact convict someone of a felony under their laws.
That's just a fundamental state sovereignty issue. That's an issue.
Well, but we have full faith and credit. We have comity. We have those kind of principles that this was a crime committed in Missouri and dealt with in Missouri. Why wouldn't we give comity to how they characterize it?
I think, frankly, we are in some sense because we're characterizing it as him having been found guilty, which is all what the documents show. He was adjudged guilty by the court upon a plea of guilty. He was found guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. We're not telling, the state of Kansas is not telling Missouri courts how they need to view their SIS system or how they need to view that abstract of conviction or however we want to term it. The state of Kansas isn't directing anyone else on how to handle that, how to label it, how to consider it. The state of Kansas is simply defining it for itself as when somebody comes into the state of Kansas, how are we going to view their prior record? And their prior record is going to be viewed through the eyes of Kansas statutes and Kansas case law as it's been developed over decades. And that's been a mainstay of Kansas law for quite some time. And I don't think it should be disturbed in this case. I don't think we should defer to other states for whether or not something is a conviction when it's a patchwork quilt of how different courts in different states view those issues. The state of Kansas has established, it's been a long-standing definition that hasn't changed in quite some time, nor have how the Kansas courts have determined something to be a conviction when the language is such as is found in this case, which is upon a plea of guilty, the defendant is found guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, he's adjudicated guilty, he's adjudged guilty, he is guilty. All that language is in the record on this case. I don't know how much farther a Missouri court could go to define for us the facts and circumstances of the underlying offense for a Kansas court to find that language constitutes a conviction. In this case, the search of the vehicle, the underpinnings of that search were not simply the ripped out baggie. There was more than that. The officer testified to that at the district court level. The state argued it at the Court of Appeals level and argues it in the brief here today. When the officer first observed this vehicle cutting through the corner parking lot, the officer was on patrol on a motorcycle. He observed the vehicle go through the parking lot. The two occupants were sitting on their seatbelts, is how he described it. He described that as a procedure whereby people try to skirt seatbelt laws by latching the seatbelt but then not having it across the front of their body. They sit on it, on the seat. He observed that. And he observed the occupants of the vehicle as they passed through that parking lot, and then he conducted the traffic stop in that parking lot. The vehicle was stopped in a lane of traffic. When the officer got off of his motorcycle and approached the vehicle and began interacting with the occupants, that's when he observed that the passenger in the front seat had reclined the seat all the way. And he found that
And the Court of Appeals found that really didn't factor into any analysis. What is she, 8 months pregnant? And that's, I would say that's a fairly typical kind of comfort and accommodation that a person in her condition would do. I mean, that doesn't enter into anything, does it?
I think it enters into something when you look at the totality of the case. If she needed that for comfort, I'm not sure why she was riding all along with the seat in the upright position to begin with. Yeah. Right when the officer stopped the vehicle, she reclined it all the way back, noticeably far back. When she was removed from the vehicle, she didn't lay down. She sat on the curb. And so that was something that factored into the officer with 17 years of training and experience. And he said that was concerning to me. That his suspicion was confirmed when he conducted the search, and that's precisely where the AK-47 was found. It was beneath her seat. And it was protruding from beneath the seat in a manner that was essentially covered up by that reclined seat. And so that's why it caught his attention. So there's a couple of factors here besides the officer's training and experience. The baggie that he saw in the center console was there, and that he knew to be packaging of narcotics. That was confirmed on the later question that he asked the defendant when he was in custody, what's the baggie for? And he said there was marijuana in it. Within a week or two, I transported marijuana in that baggie. That occurred after the search. That's part of the state's inevitable discovery argument. But those facts remain. That's part of the record in this case, as is the reclined seat and all the officers' training and experience.
And the baggie was empty, and it wasn't right. Apparent what it had contained, obviously, because the officer inquired.
Correct.
It and was so why does an empty baggie indicate that there will be drugs in the car?
The empty baggie indicates as much because the baggie was twisted off in a manner that the officer testified to, and the state outlines in its briefs lines of case law, that when a baggie is twisted off in this manner and the corner is ripped off, that is indicative of the transport of narcotics. It's not the manner in which an ordinary person with an innocuous purpose uses a baggie.
That's not my question. Why does the twisted off baggie, but why does the empty baggie, even if it would indicate that baggie had been previously used, why does that give probable cause that there's going to be drugs found in the car when it was obviously empty because he had to ask what it was for?
It's the same rationale that would posit that if somebody was stopped and there was an empty beer can on the seat, that would support the notion that there's other alcohol in the car. It would warrant a person of reasonable caution and belief that that car had been used to transport drugs recently.
Would you say the same thing if there was a AA battery on the console? If there was an empty bottle of Sudafed on the console? If there were other items that are commonly used in the production of meth or other types of things that you can just buy at the store?
If there
a book of matches? I mean, where does this take us?
If there was a series or the totality of the circumstances is the review, and if there were a number of those items together.
They use batteries all the time in the production of meth or a Sudafed.
I don't believe that would be the same as this case, because what we had in this case was a baggie that was twisted off and ripped off on the corner. And the testimony was,
twisted off. There's really no evidence of how that baggie was. I mean, that's kind of a term of art in the paraphernalia and distribution, because they use the twisted corner. But
right.
In looking at the record again, there's no evidence of how the corner was removed, whether it's twisted. It's just a baggie that it has a torn corner. That's what we have.
It is.
I mean, there was some evidence adduced about what the baggie was, because it wasn't there. And that's basically what the court concluded and what I think what the conclusion was. It was a baggie that had a removed corner. That's what we have.
Correct.
Okay.
Finally, the motion in limine, I believe, was properly granted in this case to exclude the defendant from testifying or offering evidence about the purchase of the gun in Missouri. That would have simply confused the jury. It's not an issue that was any sort of affirmative defense. His labeling of a mistake of fact was essentially a mistake of law defense as to whether or not Kansas would view him as a convicted felon. The Court of Appeals properly found that that was excluded at the trial court level and affirmed the conviction. I'd ask that you do the same.
Any more questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
You reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
May it please the court, Clayton Gillette for Cameron Howard. I think it's important, counsel for the state, just stood up here and said, I don't think Kansas should defer to Missouri. Quite frankly, what we think doesn't matter. The Kansas legislature has deferred to the federal system regarding who can own a firearm. And in doing so, they've adopted the federal system, which then defers to each state where the offense occurred. And the state has made some arguments that this maybe is not even appropriately before this court. However, that's part of issue one and issue three, whether or not he even is a felon, which is issue one, and issue three, which relates to the motion in limine. And it's part of the oral argument at the Court of Appeals, and it's part of the supplemental briefing, just like the state was able to file a supplemental briefing to flesh out some of the issues that were discussed at the Court of Appeals. Appellant Cameron Howard is also permitted to do that. And I think it's not speculation to say how Cameron Howard's ATF background check would have worked out. The records that are before this court makes it clear that Kansas and Missouri, along with 34 other states, rely 100% on the ATF background check. The ATF gives each state the option. You can 100% rely on ours, you can do your own, you can do ours and your own, and the state of Kansas has said, we're good, we're just gonna do the state's background check. It would have come back the same way, and I think it is important.
Counselor, we're really not talking about a prosecution for a dealer unlawfully selling to someone. We're talking about someone possessing a firearm in the state of Kansas, mm-hmm. whether they can purchase it here or whether Kansas has deferred to the federal system for background checks to purchase a vehicle firearm. Why does that impact whether your client could possess it?
I think it impacts it because It defines how Kansas should define a conviction based on this statute when it is adopting the federal background check, but also it relates to the requirement that this court will interpret statutes reasonably and not trying to reach an absurd result. And that's one of the results that could happen here. Interpreting the statutes in this way means that I would virtually guarantee that any agency that regularly sells firearms in the state of Kansas has violated the law and they don't know it, based on the way this statute is being interpreted.
Can you help explain that for me, please?
It's the hypothetical that Mr. Devine started with. If we want to assume that sometime after this SIS, Mr. Howard moved to Kansas and then just went out to Bass Pro Shop to buy a gun, based on the fact that they use the exact same background check, Missouri and Kansas both 100% rely on the NICS background check, Mr. Howard would have been sold a gun by Bass Pro Shop. And at that point, Bass Pro Shop, if the Court of Appeals is correct, Bass Pro Shop has sold Mr. Howard a gun, and he's a felon, and they're not supposed to sell him a gun.
Isn't the crime we have here. We don't have a dealer before us that's been charged with unlawfully selling. But what we have here is someone that's been charged with unlawfully possessing. And that person happens to have personal knowledge of what happened in Missouri because they were the defendant.
And the only means by which he could figure out if he was a felon was by doing the ATF background check. There is nothing in Kansas.
He could have read the paperwork from Missouri.
The paperwork from Missouri?
He was there, as my colleagues pointed out. Mm-hmm. He was present for the Missouri proceeding. He was aware of how it was disposed of.
And
presumably aware of the fact that there had been a finding of guilt.
And I think the state keeps saying that there was an adjudication, and I believe before this court there's a judgment that says that he is adjudged guilty. And I've quoted back to statute over in Missouri 557.011, which says that it's supposed to be that he was found guilty. The court finds that he's guilty and then has the judgment, but then suspends actually entering that judgment. So it's the judgment is, you know, it's written up, it's drawn up, but then nothing is done with it as long as he completes his SIS. And so there actually is no adjudication in Missouri based upon the way that the statute reads and the way that this is supposed to happen. But then even then, the state of Missouri then says, if you complete your SIS, you can go buy a gun. And the ATF says that you can as well. And so everything that he would have been told, other than maybe Cameron Howard should have read Pollard and predicted how this court would have come out on the decision.
Well, we go back before that. The Holmes case said it's the adjudication of guilt, not the sentencing, that makes the conviction. That was a case in which it came up in between the adjudication of guilt and before sentencing, and the Holmes case said, no, you don't have to wait till the sentencing for him to have a conviction that disqualifies possessing. And well, so once you get there where the Missouri is, they're suspending imposition of the sentence.
Mm-hmm.
And Holmes says, well, the sentence doesn't drive this wagon, it's the adjudication of guilt.
Well, and it just the way that the SIS works in Missouri, and hopefully we've explained that enough in the briefs, because I probably don't have enough time here to. But the way that it's an SIS is the judgment is never entered. The judgment of conviction is never entered in Missouri, and so there is no definition of conviction as it would be in Missouri. And part of what's happening here is that Missouri, so Kansas has sort of a tiered, different felonies. You can't own a gun for 5 years, you can't own a gun for 10 years, you can't own a gun for your life. Whereas in Missouri, they reach sort of the same result by doing these different tiered SIS, SES, because any felony conviction in Missouri means no gun forever. And so the SIS makes it so we sort of get to the same place of no owning a gun for a certain number of years in the state of Missouri by just simply never actually entering that judgment of conviction.
SIS?
SIS.
The acronym?
Yeah, SIS is suspended imposition of sentence. And that's the the procedure in Missouri that is very closely analogous to a Kansas diversion. Right. SES is the suspended execution of sentence, which is the procedure that is, I would say, is
it's just not anywhere close to a diversion. I mean, there's a diversion is something that's entered into with a prosecutor, and it's generally pre-filing, or it might be even post-filing, but there's no court action. There's no finding of guilt. It's an agreement between the prosecutor, who's not even part of the judicial branch, and the defendant to defer prosecution as long as you comply with certain conditions, and then the case is dismissed. It's not even, as far as I can see, not even close to a diversion.
Well, I mean, this is. Yeah, I mean, certainly we can. I mean, they're not identical, and how closely it's perceived is, you know, obviously, it's for this court to decide. So,
I mean, as a trial judge, we had except for DUI diversions, that's different because it's a hybrid kind of thing. We had basically nothing to do with diversions.
Well, I think it's just, I guess the analogy that I'm drawing is that sort of the end result is sort of the same, that the case,
right.
No judgment is entered, it
But there is there's no judgment of guilt in a diversion or anything like that, typically.
And I think it's important that during the SIS, the judgment is, it's created, but it's not, you know, as a term of art, it's not entered, it's not on the record in Missouri that's something that's there unless... You know, it can be used in later prosecutions that it's, you know, a repeat offense, but it's not on his record for gun ownership, et cetera.
It is a judgment of guilt. It's just not basically recorded.
Yeah, and I would say that is how you know, the Kansas statute says, you know, there must be an entry of a judgment of conviction. And in this case, you know, you have a judgment. It's just never entered as part of his record. And so by not entering it, it doesn't become a conviction in Kansas because it's never entered. And I think that's another way to say that this isn't Missouri telling Kansas, you know, you have to do what we say is and is not a conviction. But if they haven't actually entered the judgment of conviction, then it doesn't fit the statute as it would here in Kansas. And that's the distinction between this and Pollard.
Any further questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Thank you all for your arguments this morning. Court will take this matter under advisement.